Welcome to another episode of God's Glory in History. I'm your host, MC Enemy. But it's not about me. It's about the Word of God and His truth on this channel. Sometimes history, but always His story. Welcome to Sabbath Fellowship. This episode is scheduled to be aired Friday, June 24th, 2022. On this channel is the history that you need because Yesiah did bleed. All the rest will come when he comes on his steed. And yes, Yeshua is just a Hebrew version of Jesus. It's I am, or you are the Messiah. Short for you are the Messiah. Don't forget the prayer of Paul to the Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 through 21. If you read it, it will bless you with understanding of God's word and his love for you. If you haven't done so yet or you're new to this channel, we ask that you download at least two Bible apps. And we ask that you make one of those Bible apps, the 1611 King James Bible with the Apocrypha. There are additional books in there that you cannot get in the standard 66 book version. And don't only download these Bible apps. I want you to follow along and read. Read with me. That's the word of God. Let it minister to you. And the reason why we say at least two Bible apps right in the middle of your screen, the facts of every case must be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. All right, so I'm going to show you guys some more headlines. I'm still trying to get some people's attention before we get into the episode. So yes, be ready. Beyonce is poised for her next revolution. Dated 16th of June, 2022. Going to be on the cover of Vogue magazine. And she is sitting on a red horse. If you don't know what that symbolism means, to the right of your screen, Revelation chapter 6, verse 4, 1611 King James Bible, it is written. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. Now, I don't know if it's media hype or is it true, but you can see there is quite a bit of killing taking place. Planets align in morning sky. This is a picture 1 hour before the sunrise on June 24th. So this is scheduled to be on this Friday morning, the same day that this is going to be released, that right before sunrise, five planets are aligning. Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. And also our moon is in there as well. So they all lining up. What's the importance of that? Got you covered. Luke chapter 21, verse 25, 1611 King James Bible. And this is Jesus speaking. It is written, and there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. World news, survivors dig through villages after Afghanistan quake kills more than 1,000. On the left of your screen, Luke chapter 21, verse 10, it is written, then said he unto them, nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes shall be in diverse places, and famines and pestilences and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven, which also ties in with that last one. I believe that was also Jesus speaking. So my bad if that's the case, that it was not put in red. This is just a little bonus thing I threw in there just because I want you guys to go do a little bit of checking. You ever heard of a metal called coltan? Probably not. Well, coltan is a very abundant mineral in Congo, which is in Central Africa. This is the real life vibranium of Wakanda. It's essential to run our electronic products. So I want you to go give it a search and check it out and see how Congo is being dealt with for this mineral. But they're showing you a small-scale mining initiative camp there. This is one of the few, as they say, that is conflict-free. So hopefully I got your attention with these things. And let's get into the episode number 111. How the Nephilim survived the flood. And as a subtitle, I got Raising Cain-aan. Let's get to work. Yeah, Satan's deception is coupled with Adam and Eve's disobedience. It opened the door to Abel's death and man's downfall. So we're going to look at pre-flood, focus on Cain. People survived the flood, focus on the wife of Ham. And after the flood or post-flood, focus on Cain-aan. All right, so pre-flood, Cain. 1611 King James Bible, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. It is written, and this is after Adam and Eve have been put out of the garden, or right around that time they were put out of the garden, and God was pronouncing his judgment on the players of the so-called insurrection or the disobedience, you know, the deception by the serpent. And he told the serpent, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So what is enmity? It's the state of feeling of being actively opposed or hostile to someone or something. So he's going to make the woman and the serpent, he's going to make a hostile state between their seeds. So Satan does have a seed, tells you right there in the beginning. Then it says in her seed. Now women don't have seed, they have eggs. So in that case, I believe it's referring to her offspring. So I use that as a subtitle of Raising Cain, because that's just a saying that people have. And just explaining it here, says, because Cain was the first murderer, having killed his brother Abel. People use that expression, raising Cain, to describe acts of violence, criminal activity, or any other mischievous acts. Section 11, King James Bible, Genesis chapter 4, verses 5 through 7, it is written, but unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door. And unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. So he says it right there. Hey, if you do right, I'm going to accept you. Obviously, he did not, because he took on that spirit of Satan and committed the first murder. 16:11 King James Bible, Jubilee, chapter 4, verses 2 and 3, it is written, and in the first year of the third Jubilee, Cain slew Abel, because God accepted the sacrifice of Abel and did not accept the offering of Cain. And he slew him in the field, and his blood cried from the ground to heaven, complaining because he had slain him. And I just put in a highlight, you know, did there, and on Monday year, so this is year 99 to year 105, somewhere in there where this is supposedly have happened. And that can correspond to about 3600 BC on the Gregorian calendar. That's the calendar I think that we use today, just to put it in perspective. So 3600 BC approximately, right? So that would have put us right there towards the end of what they call the Stone Age, right? And entering into the Iron Age. And 1611 King James Bible, Joshua chapter 1, verse 25, kind of confirms this. It says, and Cain hastened and rose up and took the iron part of his plowing instrument, with which he suddenly smote his brother and slew him. And Cain spilt the blood of his brother Abel upon the earth. And the blood of Abel streamed upon the earth before the flock. So he was using an iron instrument. Section 11, King James Bible, Genesis chapter 6, verse 4, it is written, there were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. So for there to be giants after the flood, there had to be either another transgression of the angels, and now that's not mentioned anywhere in the Bible, or hiding on board the ark with the survivors of the flood. Now that's just a logical conclusion, and I'm gonna see how let you see where I got that conclusion from as we progress. 16:11 King James Bible, Jubilees chapter 7, verse 21 and 22. It is written, for owing to these three things came the flood upon the earth. Namely, owing to the fornication wherein the watchers against the law of their ordinance went a-whoring after the daughters of men and took themselves wives of all which they chose. And they made the beginning of uncleanliness. And they begat sons, the Nephilim. And they were all unalike unlike, and they devoured one another. And the giant slew the Nephil, and the Nephil slew the Eljo, and the Eljo mankind, and one man another. So we're going to have to do a study at some point, because now I'm curious as to see the difference between the giants, the Nephil or Nephilim, and the Eljo. I'm real curious about that now. But I have to go do as I'm led. Sixteen, 11 King James Bible, Jubilees, chapter 5, verse 23. It is written, and he entered the sixth year thereof, 1308, anno Mundi, in the second month, and on the new moon of the second month, till the 16th, and he entered, and all that we brought to him. Remember, this Jubilees is from the perspective of the angels. Into the ark, and the Lord closed it from without or outside on the 17th evening. So that's approximately 2400 BC, if I got that correct, making that conversion. But that the fact that the Lord closed the ark door, it just brought another scripture to my mind. Revelation chapter 3, verse 7, it is written, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and shutteth, and no man openeth. So you church folks, know the difference, I mean the saying. If God opens the door, nobody can close it. So what's for you, what God has for you is for you. So now we're gonna move on to the people that survived the flood with a focus on the wife of Ham. Now, why am I focusing on her? She's going to appear to be the weakest link by process of elimination based on the scriptures. Now, there's no genealogy information given on any of the wives of Noah's sons. However, Ham's children are the ones that we are told go off track. So let's take a look. 1611 King James Bible, Genesis chapter 6, verse 8 through 10, it is written, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations. And Noah walked with God. And Noah begat three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. So Noah, perfect in his generation. So he had none of that fallen angel DNA, no Eljo, no Nephilim DNA in him, right? So now that still leaves the possibility of his wife or the wives of his sons. Well, it can't be Noah's wife, because if she was corrupted with those other DNAs, then that means his sons would have been corrupted with. And we know that through the line of Shem came Christ, and he had to have that perfect, clean bloodline. 1611 King James Bible, Jubilees, chapter 7, verse 13 through 17. It is written, and Ham knew that his father had cursed his younger son, and he was displeased that he had cursed his son, and he parted from his father. He and his sons with him, Cush and Mizraim, Put and Canaan. Or you could pronounce it, some people could pronounce it Canaan, but we all usually just say Canaan. so that you don't see that eye there. But it led me to think about Cain and Cain-aan. That evil was just being transferred, right? I'm going to continue read. And he built him, he built for himself a city, and he called its name after the name of his wife. This is Ham. His wife's name is Naal-latamauk. And Japheth saw that Ham built the city, or saw it, and became envious of his brother. And he too built the city for himself and called it after the name of his wife. Adatanis says. And Shem dwelt with his father Noah, and he built a city close to his father on the mountain. And he too called its name after the name of his wife, Siddiqui Telebab. You can't tell me these are not swarthy people, aka black people with those kind of names. But I digress. And behold, these three cities are near Mount Lubar, Siddiqui Telebab, fronting the mountain on its east, and Naal-latamauk on the south, and Adanatesis toward the west. Now, that actually lines up with one of the studies we did before when we were talking about them casting lots and getting their plots of land. It does line up with that, saying Ham went to the south, Shem had the east, and Japheth had the west. It lines up. So this is an article I was reading. It's called The Bible Truth, dated 16th of December of 2013. And I just pulled out some excerpts because it enhances our study here. The Bible says that only Noah was perfect in his generations. But what about Noah's wife and his sons and their wives, three wives? In the Book of Jubilees, known to have been in use from the late 2nd century BC, the names of the wives of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth are as follows. So the wife of Noah, it says, is Emzara, daughter of Rachiel, son of Methuselah. So she has a lineage. But the wives of his sons, there was no lineage given. But they did give the names. Now, I said before that I think Naal-latamauk seems to be the bad fruit. And why is that? Well, because Matthew 7, verses 17 through 18 and verse 20 reads this way: even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. So we're going to look at the wife's fruit with Ham, which is their children. Reading on in some more, says it adds that the three sons, after some years, struck out in different directions from the original camp near Mount Ararat, and founded three villages bearing the names of these three mothers of the human race. We know the names of Noah's sons. We know that the lineage of Shem cannot be corrupted, as Jesus comes from that line of Shem. But what about Ham and Japheth? The genealogy is seen in Genesis chapter 10. Once we realize that Ham had a son by the name of Cush, and Cush had a son named Nimrod, in Genesis chapter 10, verse 8, it all starts to unravel. If Noah and his family were the only ones on the earth immediately after the flood, then it becomes apparent that corruption starts there somewhere. But where? Who is Nimrod? Nimrod means the rebellious one. Nimrod was the ruler of the kingdom of Babel, and numerous scriptures indicate that he was a giant, or a quote-unquote mighty man. Remember what we said about mighty men, right? Being offspring of the fallen ones, the fallen angels. I'll continue reading. The fallen angels taught the men to use the use of magic and invoking demons so that they would obey man. This started being explained into the Egyptians, Persians, and Babylonian history. And this information is used today and is known as the Jewish Kabbalah knowledge. And many celebrities practice this occult religion openly. Some Satanism uses this knowledge as well. According to Greek history, Nimrod, who was called Nerus, was handed the knowledge, and by it caused him to turn away from God. He started practicing the erratic superstitions and started being governed by the stars and the planets instead. Get this. Other names given to Nimrod after the Tower of Babel were Gilgamesh, Baal, Orion, Osiris, Marduk, Apollo. All these names, depending on the origin, we're still talking about the same person, Nimrod. Nimrod was the ruler of the Old World Order. All statues portray these individuals to be the same person. Orion constellation is the hunter of lions. Statues holding lions or fighting lions. The symbolism is deliberate. Defiance becomes apparent when Jesus is known as the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. Still in the excerpts from that article. So what about the Ham's other sons? Is there any proof that they had corrupted seed? Ham's other son, Mizraim, Genesis chapter 10, verse 6, had a son by the name of Caphtorium. He is named the father of the Philistines, which we know absolutely from biblical scripture that at least five giants were Philistines, Goliath and his four brothers. They settled the island of Crete, which is not coincidentally in Greek mythology, is where all the Greek gods come from. Canaan, also one of Ham's sons, we know, are the roots of the Canaanites. The Canaanites were ordered by God to be taken out by Joshua and his boys. And David and his men later took out Goliath or the Philistines. Very interesting. All this stuff ties together. All right, so let's look after the flood. And we want to focus on Canaan. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 1, verse 8, it is written, "Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not of Joseph." Now, this always baffled me because I'm like, well, if the new king came into power, how would he not know who Joseph was when Joseph was the second in command? I got my answer. 1611 King James Bible, Jubilees, chapter 46. And I got some various verses up there. You can see them on the top of the screen. It is written, "And there was no Satan nor any evil in all the days of the life of Joseph, which he lived after his father Jacob. For all the Egyptians honored the children of Israel all the days of the life of Joseph. And he died and all his brethren and all that generation. And he commanded the children of Israel before he died that they should carry his bones with them when they went forth from the land of Egypt. And Joseph died in the 46th Jubilee in the sixth week in the second year, and they buried him in the land of Egypt. 2242 and on Monday, all his brethren died after him." And here it is. And the king of Egypt went to war with the king of Canaan. 2263 anno Mundi. In the 47th Jubilee, in the second week, in the second year. And the children of Israel brought forth all the bones of the children of Jacob, except the bones of Joseph. And they buried them in the field in the double cave in the mountain. And the king of Canaan was victorious over the king of Egypt. And he closed the gates of Egypt. And he devised an evil device against the children of Israel by afflicting them. And he said unto the people of Egypt, behold, the people of the children of Israel have increased in number, increased and multiplied more than we. Come, let us deal with wisely with them before they become too many, and let us afflict them with slavery before war come upon us, and before they too fight against us. Else they will join themselves unto our enemies and get them up out of our land, for their hearts and faces are toward the land of Canaan. So there it is. The Pharaoh, or the king that arose that didn't know of Joseph, wasn't really of Egypt. He was actually of Canaan, and he fought against Egypt and took over Egypt. So once again, the Canaanites, who we know have that fallen one DNA, was the one who instituted that slavery and hard labor on our people. Can't beat this book. I dare you to try. 1611 King James Bible, Numbers chapter 13, various verses. It is written, of the tribe of Ephraim, Oshea, the son of Nun. These are the names of the men which Moses sent to spy out the land. And Moses called Oshea, the son of Nun, Joshua. And that name is written the same way as the Hebrew name of Jesus. Remember, we didn't have J back then. It was a Y. And it was Yehoshua. And Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said unto them, get you up this way southward and go up into the mountain. And they ascended by the south and came into Hebron, where Ahiman, Shishai, Talmai, the children of Anak were. Continuing on, but the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were in our own sights as grasshoppers. And so we were in their sights. So there's those giants again. Mighty men, giants. 1611 King James Bible, Amos chapter 2, verse 9. It is written, yet destroyed I the Amorites before them, whose height was like the height of the cedars, about the trees. And he was strong as the oaks. Yet I destroyed his fruit from above and his roots from beneath. So the Amorites were also tall people, just like those Amalekites, those giants. Here's another article here that I was reading. The Canaanites Live, DNA Reveals the Fate of Biblical People. And this was published July 28th of 2017. And it says, a burial jar containing the remains of an ancient inhabitant of the Canaanite city of Sidon. This individual was one of five whose DNA was sequenced to reveal the ancestry of the Canaanites. The burial jar contained the remains of an ancient inhabitant of the Canaanite city of Sidon. This individual was one of five whose DNA was sequenced to reveal the ancestry of the Canaanites. The people of modern-day Lebanon can trace their genetic ancestry back to the Canaanites. new research finds. Reading on, the Canaanites were residents of the Levant, or modern-day Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, Israel, and Palestine. During the Bronze Age, starting at about 4,000 years ago, they're best known from the Old Testament of the Bible, in which they're described as the cursed descendants of Canaan. Blighted by God because the Canaan's father dishonored his own father, the patriarch Noah. The Canaanites were often in conflict with the Israelite tribes that wrote the Hebrew Bible. In fact, the book of Deuteronomy features God ordering the Canaanites to be exterminated, in part because the Canaanites kept their records on easily degradable papyrus rather than clay. Little is known about their side of the story, but now ancient DNA reveals the Canaanites were descendants of Stone Age settlers and the ancestors of the Lebanese. So that's a full circle, right? We were talking about the Stone Age when Cain slew Abel. Romans 16:11, King James Bible, Romans chapter 8, verses 14 and 16. It is written, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God." So this takes us right back to that beginning, when the Lord told Cain, you will be accepted if you do right. And what is right? Following his laws, being led by the Spirit. Or actually, I can just say just being led by the Spirit, because the Spirit is not going to lead you astray. It's the Spirit of truth. The truth is the law. The truth is what God wants you to do or to be. So if you want to accept your invitation to be among the children of the Most High God, I got a suggested prayer for you. You can pause the video and you can read this suggested prayer with sincerity in your heart. If you choose to do so, let me be the first to welcome you to the family. On this channel, we don't make orphans. So I give you a three-step process on how to further your walk in the faith. You're just beginning if you just recited that prayer. Not going to leave you hanging. Three steps, real easy. Read your Bible daily. I know it's difficult, so I created an episode, episode 62 on this channel, how to read the Bible. Step number two, find a Bible-based place to grow. This place has to be one that continually asks, what does the Bible say? What saith the Lord? And then step number three is to pray without ceasing. This is where you talk to God, but make sure that you couple that with step number one so that he can talk back to you. The Lord is looking for worshipers to worship him in spirit and in truth. And if you're not doing step number one, you're missing out on the truth. All right, here's the various places that we are on. If you like this episode, give it a thumbs up. But again, as I always say, it's more important to me that you share these episodes with others. It's our duty as followers of Christ, followers of the Messiah, to spread his gospel. And if you haven't done so, we ask you to consider subscribing to this channel. If you need to drop me a line in the comments, I'd love to hear from you guys. And as always, I just want to thank you guys for your continued support, for watching. As always, worship the Father, praise the Son, and accept the Holy Spirit. May our Lord and Savior grant you his peace that surpasses all understanding. May it rest, rule, and abide with you, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen.